the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Episcopal Church, as always, aims to strike a balance in what we do in worship services and to be clear about why we're doing it. This applies to Ash Wednesday too, an increasingly popular form of public worship. Ash Wednesday marks the end of a cycle, one of those patterns, cycles with beginnings and ends, cycles within cycles, woven into the church's year to help us to be better Christians. We need the help. This cycle began last Palm Sunday in 2012, when we cheered and waved our palms with the crowds that hailed Jesus on his final entry into Jerusalem. Of course, we waved these rather dainty little palms woven into the shape of crosses. But clergy, for very good reasons, they get the full palm frond like this. Hosanna, Hosanna. The cycle has come to an end today. Last year's palms, crosses, and fronds have been burned, and they are now ash. There's a powerful symbol here, and that symbolic act of burning is compounded with another symbol. The ash from our palm is used to draw a cross on our forehead. Why? What does that mean? This has been another year in which, despite our best intentions, we failed to be the followers of Christ we are called to be. All of us have failed. The church has failed. Our nation has failed. The human species has failed. Put bluntly, this has been yet another year of sins of commission and omission, what we've done and what we have failed to do. It's rather more serious than the list of New Year's resolutions that we made so frivolously and then failed to keep again. This ash represents our failed promises. The ash and the terrible words pronounced over us as that cross is drawn on our forehead tells us that another year has gone by, and they drive us into the arid desert of Lent, a penitential season. There are other symbols, other cycles. Once a year, on Good Friday, we Christians are required to look directly at the cross and the crucifixion. It's morbid to dwell on that overly much. Indeed, we're discouraged from doing so, but never to be confronted by that hideous public death would undermine Christianity, would result in a faith so shallow, so superficial, that it wouldn't be worthy of the name Christianity at all. This Lent will end, like every Lent before, with Palm Sunday, Holy Week, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday. And then, gloriously, comes the great feast of the Resurrection, Easter, the greatest day in the Christian year, every year. The saving act of God in Christ, risen, ascended, glorified, this is the greatest symbol, the greatest cycle of all. There are grounds for such great joy at the heart of our faith. But compare and contrast, there is also our response. We continue to sin. If we say we have no sin, the truth is not in us, said the old prayer book. And now we see the rationale behind Palm Sunday cycling into ashes. Every single week, we say the words of the general confession and hear the promise of Christ's forgiveness and God's eternal love for each of us. But saying the words without actually meaning them or even thinking about them and how they might apply to us, that's mere hypocrisy. The more extreme language of the old prayer book has gone out of fashion. Consumers don't like it. We don't want to hurt anyone's feelings by having to acknowledge that we are, in fact, miserable sinners, and that there is no health in us, and no amount of going to the gym will make us better. To say such fierce old words might make us realize that we've been getting away with saying the confession with no prior examination of conscience and no real engagement with our need for repentance and true amendment of life. We slid by week after week until today. So once a year, after our all too general confessions, we're confronted by who we are, ultimately. And we are confronted by the fact that another year has gone by. We've allowed our life to slip through our fingers again for another year. Time is running out for us, and still we have failed to repent. Of course, that's not really a very cheerful uplift message with a vague little exhortation to do better, is it? Well, it's not really meant to be. As the priest draws a cross made of ashes on our forehead, we have to hear words we really don't want to hear. Remember, O man, the dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. As I pronounce these words when I do this, I always try and look people right in the eye. You can see the same cross on my forehead that I draw on yours. Sometimes, actually, I can hardly bear to do this. It's so painful, especially for children or dear friends or, you know, people who are here among us every single day, every single week. It's very hard to know that you too are mortal, and I too am mortal, and we are not in a state of grace. Ash Wednesday is an anti-complacency service. Ash Wednesday is uncomfortable, or worse, and that's better. Once a year, we must do this. Once a year, the cycle has come to an end. Ash Wednesday insists, it doesn't just remind us, it insists that we take the call to repentance seriously. Christ calls us to mean our confession. So what should we do? Our Episcopal practice is to come here every Sunday full of hope, having prepared ourselves to receive the glorious tokens of Christ's redeeming work. But first, we must repent and mean it. Confess and mean it. Then we are forgiven and may know that sudden lifting up of the heart because God means it. Now, on page 447 of the Book of Common Prayer, the Episcopal Church provides for those with troubled consciences a more, shall we say, individual service, which all may choose to employ, though none need to, but some should. If that is your need, please see one of the clergy, and we will be very privileged to help you to find the peace of heart our loving God is prompting you to seek. Once again, it is Ash Wednesday. A serious day with a serious message. But we have even less time this year than last year for true repentance and amendment of life. Remember, O man, that dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. Lord, have mercy upon us.